At the beginning of mixing, the primary focus is on hydrating flour components. Water interacts with both starch granules and gluten proteins, leading to swelling and increased mobility. At this stage, starch granules remain intact. Gluten proteins exist primarily as discrete masses with minimal interaction, and a continuous gluten network has not yet been formed. As mixing continues, mechanical energy along with hydration significantly impacts the dough's components. It triggers thiol disulfide exchange reactions within the gluten proteins. This process involves the breaking and reformation of disulfide bonds, significantly impacting the gluten network. During mixing, we can take a look at the free self-hydro group content to gain valuable insights into the dynamics of this disulfide bond formation and breakage. A decline in free self-hydro content indicates the formation of new disulfide bonds, leading to increased cross-linking between gluten and proteins. Conversely, an increase in free self-hydro content signals the breaking of existing disulfide bonds, which could result in gluten depolymerization. As mixing progresses, hydrogen bond interactions increase. This increase is attributed to the thorough contact between flour and water. It's fully hydrated, promoting interactions between proteins, the enhanced binding of protein and water molecules, increased hydrogen bonding between protein molecules. Gluten molecules, being large polymers, are particularly susceptible to stretching and alignment under mechanical forces. They begin to unfold and orient themselves in the direction of the force. As gluten molecules stretch and align, they come into closer proximity, facilitating the formation of various intermolecular bonds. This alignment allows the gluten molecules to interact with each other more effectively, forming a continuous network throughout the dough. To compare with what happened to the colloidal crystals in the study we mentioned before, the entangled dislocation of the crystals ended up making the entire structure stronger, while here, the entanglement and alignment of the gluten molecules lead to a stronger dough. To sum it up, this alignment of gluten molecules under stress leads to strain hardening. The entire process is crucial for the development of the gluten network's strength and elasticity. Now let's focus on the gluten and macropolymers, or GMP for short. At the start, mixing initially depolymerizes GMPs by breaking down the initial spherical gluten particles into smaller, irregularly shaped particles. This process is essential for the even distribution of gluten and the formation of a continuous network. Interestingly, this study also suggests that a certain proportion of gliadin and gluten can initially promote polymerization of gluten before depolymerization occurs as mixing time increases. However, excessive mixing can lead to a weaker gluten network with reduced elasticity, as evidenced by lower extension resistance. This is due to the excessive breakdown of the gluten network and a decrease in GMP content. Obviously, different levels of mechanical energy during mixing will bring out different results. High mechanical energy mixing brings intense force and rapid development. This approach often employed in industrial settings and represented by processes like the Chorleywood bread process, utilizes high-speed mixers to deliver a significant amount of mechanical energy in a short time. This results in rapid dough development, typically within a few minutes. The high mechanical energy input initially causes a breakdown of large gluten and macropolymers into smaller units, exposing thiol groups for disulfide bond formation. This process is essential for building a strong gluten network, as we mentioned. During mixing and subsequent resting, these smaller gluten units re-aggregate to form a more extensive network, characterized by enhanced strength and elasticity. High mechanical energy mixing typically leads to increased strain hardening and higher stress resistance. Doughs mixed with high energy exhibit greater resistance to deformation, reflecting the robust gluten network development. But there are some potential drawbacks with high mechanical energy mixing, such as overmixing risk. Excessive energy input can disrupt the gluten network, causing a weakening of the structure, resulting in decreased elasticity and increased stickiness. High mechanical energy mixing is not suitable for all flour types. Flours with lower protein content might be overdeveloped under these conditions. On the other hand, low mechanical energy mixing results in gentle force and gradual development of the gluten network. This approach, often associated with hand kneading or slower speed mixing, involves a more gradual application of mechanical energy. Dough development takes longer compared to high energy methods. While the fundamental principles of gluten development remain the same, the lower energy input results in a less aggressive breakdown of GMPs. The gluten network forms more slowly, potentially leading to a different structure and rheological characteristics compared to high energy mixing. Low mechanical energy mixing may result in moderate strain hardening. The dough's resistance to stretching might not be as pronounced as in high energy mixed doughs. It may also have lower stress resistance. The dough might exhibit lower resistance to large deformations due to the less developed gluten network. But in terms of benefits, the gentle approach minimizes the risk of damaging the gluten network, potentially leading to a more extensible and less sticky dough. It can also be more forgiving for flours with varying protein contents and qualities. So there is a complex interplay between mixing intensity, gliadin and gluten-in ratio, and GMP dynamics. Gliadins play a crucial role in facilitating interactions within the developing gluten network. Being smaller and more globular, again, they act as a plasticizer, contributing to dough extensibility and cohesiveness. Gliadins may interact with glutenins and with each other, filling the spaces around glutenin polymers and contributing to a continuous network. During mixing, gliadins can form hydrogen bonds with starch granules, contributing to the development of a temporary physical network that influences dough properties. However, this network is generally less stable than the one formed by glutenin later on, and excessive mixing can disrupt these bonds. The impact of mixing on beta sheet content appears to be influenced by the ratio of gliadin to glutenin in the dough. A study using model doughs with different gliadin and glutenin ratios found that the changes in beta sheet content during mixing vary depending on the ratio. As mixing progresses and becomes excessive, the beta sheet content may decrease due to the depolymerization of glutenin macropolymers. The mechanical stress from overmixing could disrupt the hydrogen bonds and other interactions that stabilize the beta sheet structure, leading to a less ordered conformation. Gliadins rich in alpha helices play a critical role in dough viscosity and extensibilities. Continuous mixing allows for the development of a gluten network that progressively encapsulates the starch granules. At optimal mixing times, the starch granules are well embedded within the gluten network, contributing to a smooth and cohesive dough structure. Dough development doesn't end with mixing, though. The resting period after mixing is crucial for the relaxation and rearrangement of dough components. While some relaxation may occur, glutenins retain their orientation from the mixing stage, contributing to the directional strength of the dough. Resting also facilitates repolymerization of glutenin, leading to an increase in GMP content. The repolymerization of GMP during resting is thought to be driven by the reformation of disulfide bonds between glutenin subunits. The rate and extent of GMP recovery are influenced by factors like resting time, mixing intensity, and flour variety. Resting generally leads to a more ordered protein secondary structure, potentially contributing to an increase in beta sheet content. As the gluten proteins absorb water and swell, they facilitate the formation of new disulfide bonds between glutenin subunits, which may lead to a greater proportion of beta sheets. The duration of the resting period can impact the beta sheet structure. Excessively long resting times may result in the breakdown of large GMP particles, potentially leading to a decrease in beta sheet content and undoing all the progress we made earlier. Multiple factors can contribute to the breakdown of GMP during prolonged resting: protease activation, disulfide bond cleavage, and microbial activity. Proteases present in wheat flour can be activated during resting, potentially by thiohydrocarbons like cysteine. These activated proteases can then break down glutenin macropolymers, reducing their size and potentially affecting their structure. extended resting times can lead to the expansion of GMP peptide chains as well, causing stress on the disulfide bonds that hold the polymers together. This stress can result in disulfide bond cleavage, weakening the GMP structure and leading to its breakdown. It's worth noting that microbial activity could also contribute to protein degradation during prolonged resting, especially if the resting conditions are favorable for microbial growth. The ideal resting time for optimal gluten network formation seems to be around 30 to 60 minutes. Beyond this, the negative effects like reduced GMP content and irregular particle sizes are observed. Now, many studies highlight three distinct regimes of mixing: undermixed, optimally mixed, and overmixed. Each regime impacts the gluten in particles and their network formation, ultimately affecting the dough's elasticity and extensibility. In an undermixed dough, flour particles and water may not be evenly distributed. Small, unmixed patches of dough may persist. The gluten proteins may not have been fully hydrated and stretched. Gluten in particles are only partially dissociated and not evenly dispersed throughout the dough, resulting in a discontinuous and weak gluten network. Undermixed dough can be difficult to handle, requiring longer resting times to improve extensibility. The size of gluten in aggregates formed during resting plays a critical role in dough properties. In an undermixed dough, the final size of gluten in aggregates after resting is smaller due to the limited breakdown of particles. Doughs in this regime exhibit weaker interactions between gluten and particles. This leads to lower dough elasticity and extensibility, leading to inconsistencies in dough texture. They are stiff and less able to retain gas during proofing and baking compared to optimally mixed dough. Now, an optimally mixed dough represents the sweet spot for gluten development, where the highest viscoelasticity is achieved. It is characterized by a high degree of gluten in particle dissociation and reassembly during dough rest. The size and interaction properties of gluten in particles at this stage favor a strong physical reassembly mechanism. Gluten in reassembly starts immediately after mixing, forming larger aggregates compared to undermixed dough. The point of optimal mixing, often identified as the time to peak in rheological measurements, represents a stage where the gluten network has reached maximum development. These optimally mixed doughs exhibit the highest elasticity and extensibility, allowing for optimal gas retention and expansion during fermentation and baking, leading to desirable bread volume and texture as expected. Overmixing involves continued mixing beyond the optimal point, leading to disruption of gluten in aggregates. There is an indication of a high degree of particle breakdown. While overmixed doughs still form a continuous protein network, the final size of gluten in aggregates is smaller compared to optimally mixed dough. Excessive mixing weakens the gluten network and leads to a slack and sticky dough. In summary, the mixing process is essential for the development of the gluten network, as it causes gluten proteins to stretch, align, and interact. The resting period is equally important, as it allows for the relaxation, rearrangement, and repolymerization of gluten proteins, further strengthening and stabilizing the gluten network.